Welcome to Guest Baptist Church this morning. It's good to have each of you with us. Do have a few announcements this morning. Remember that tonight after service we will have conference. Brother Ryan Barentine is preaching tonight, so we invite you back at 6 o'clock for that. And then again, we do have conference following that service. Go ahead and mark your calendars for April the 14th through 17th. That will be our youth revival. So just keep that in mind. Also, speaking of youth, I know myself and everybody that was at the Valentine's last night really had a good time. We appreciate Brother Josh and Miss April and all the youth for everything they did last night. And we just really appreciate them. So just wanted to throw that in this morning. Several sign-up sheets in the foyer, including the pictures and info for the tractor. That ends today. We will discuss that at conference this evening. So if you've been waiting to the last moment, it is here. So you need to handle that. There are a few other sign-up sheets. Gridiron Men's Conference, Meal Train are the ones that come to mind. But just check that before you leave today. One thing that's not in here but you should know about is March the 9th. That is a Saturday. We're going to have a work day here at the church starting at 8 o'clock. Several things outside that need to be done, a few things inside. So whatever you think you can do to help, come that day and join us and help do a few things around here. Offering plates are in the foyer. Wednesday nights we have dinner at 5:30, Bible study at 6. Invite you out for that. There's a bucket in the back for snacks for students. You can see Miss Mitchell. And we do have a nursery in the back for children up to 5 or as you head into the foyer that you can use as needed. Are there any other announcements this morning? O'clock at Nazareth. Brother Ethan's going to be giving his testimony. I'll pray for him. And if you feel led to do so, that will be over at Nazareth tonight. Anybody else?
Yes.
Sure. Yeah. I'm not sure if we know yet what exactly we're going to do, but we will get that and let everyone know. Anyone else this morning? All right, thank you so much.
All these guys are coming up here. We're going to sing one, and then we'll meet and greet. If you've got a song on your heart, come up here and let me know. We'll get that worked out and get on. Thank you.
like to welcome everybody out this morning. Hope everybody's doing well. And we're just certainly glad that you're here this morning, especially our visitors. We just want you to know that you are welcome this morning and ask you just to make yourself at home. As Brother Ryan's already said, we do appreciate the Valentine's banquet that we had last night. Had a good time. I'm pretty sure Sam and Caleb tried to kill me for a little while, but I told Caleb he's going to bring something stronger than that. We had a great time and appreciate everything, Brother Josh and April. Let's give them a round of applause right quick. All right. Any prayer requests this morning? Yeah, we got several families this morning that are traveling. Kids are out of school tomorrow, so remember them as they travel. So you got some folks sick as well, and so y'all be praying for them. Good to see the Mitchells back, feeling better, but still got some folks sick, so y'all pray for them. Any others this morning?
Please remember my grandfather's funeral.
Yes. Any others?
All the Marys last night.
Yes. If you were in the news, it was Joey. Yeah, y'all are here. Not sitting beside each other, but they're here. I'm just kidding.
You gotta have that space.
All right. Well, like I said, it's good to have each of you here this morning, and we're certainly glad that you're here, and just ask you to be obedient and worship the Lord with us this morning. We do have a very special prayer request this morning. I'm going to get Brother Jacob, if he would, to come up. Brother Jacob is going to Ghana, if I'm not mistaken. When you leaving?
A week from Thursday.
A week from this Thursday. Going over there for a week?
2 weeks.
2 weeks. Going to be in Ghana for 2 weeks. Going on a mission trip with a group from his school. And he's excited and nervous. I know Mom and Dad are nervous, that's a long one. How long have you been in there for?
12 hours.
12 hours? One way?
And then 5 more.
Oh, my goodness. So, but I do believe what God's Word says about itself. The Lord says this, that when His Word goes out, that it does not return to Him void without accomplishing what He wants it to accomplish. And so we're trusting that promise this morning. And so we're going to pray for all the prayer requests that was mentioned and Brother Jacob. Traveling grace, and that the Lord would already be preparing hearts as he goes and preaches. Says he's going to get to preach with a translator. And so you speak a little plainer now. The translator have a hard time translating for me. But so y'all just remember Brother Jacob over the next few weeks. I think he's got an event to work next week at school, so he's not going to be here. So, it's going to be a little bit before we see him. And I'm so proud of him, thankful for him, and the growth that he's had in his ministry, and just excited about this opportunity for him. So, I'm going to ask everybody, if you would, to stand. Let's come down here to the front. I'm going to ask our deacons if they would come to the front. I know John's not here, and Brother Josh, if he would come. And we're going to lay hands on Brother Jacob and ask you just to pray as well. All right, let's pray. Father, we come to you this morning, God, just thanking you for another day, opportunity to come to your house this morning. What a privilege and a blessing that it is, Father God. We thank you for each one that's gathered this morning. God, we pray that you would just bless them. Father God, we pray for each request that was mentioned this morning, Father God, those that are sick, hurting, God, those that are traveling, God, those that are mourning loss of loved ones, Father. God, we pray that you would just touch and bless those as only as you can. And God, we just thank you for that. Father God, right now we lift up Brother Jacob to you, Father God. We thank you for him, his family, and what he means to this church, Father. God, we thank you for his ministry, God, that you called him to preach the gospel of Christ. God, we thank you for his faithfulness to do that. And God, as you've called him to go on this mission trip in Ghana, oh Father God, I pray that you would grant him traveling grace. God, I pray that you would go ahead of him, God. You would get everything, every distraction out of the way, God. You would prepare the way for him to go and to preach the gospel. God, we pray for hearts that are going to receive the gospel, God, that you would go ahead and be preparing minds and hearts to receive that which they're going to hear. And Father God, we pray for, God, God, we pray for his physical protection as he's there, God, from disease or whatnot. God, that you would just watch over him in that manner as well. And God, that you would just be glorified through this trip. God, as I already mentioned, Father, we're trusting the promises of your word this morning, God. That when your word goes out, it does not return void, God. We thank you for that promise, God. What a promise. And God, God, you've been found faithful time and time again to your word. And God, we trust you again this morning. So God, right now, I pray that you would just put your hand and your hedge of protection around Jacob as he goes. And God, you would just bless him and use him in a mighty way. And Father God, we're going to be careful to give you all the glory. It's in Christ's name that we pray this morning. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
This time we'll have a time of fellowship. Tell somebody you love them this morning.
Sure y'all have heard of, or y'all have heard plenty of times, it's about Jesus calling the first disciples. Does anybody know what those guys was doing when he called them? That's right. And we talk about this story a lot, and I'm just going to read a couple verses. And it says, "And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And he saith unto them, Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And they straightway left their nets and followed him." And that's the story as Matthew recorded it. And a lot of times, that story to preach about it or teach about it, but as I was thinking about what I wanted to talk to y'all this week, and as, you know, getting prepared for this trip I'm about to go on, this story's just been on my heart. And if you look over in Luke, how he reported it, the story, Jesus is walking by the sea, and it says that in verse 2 of Luke 5 that he saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were going out of them and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land, and he sat down and taught the people at the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep, and let down your nets for a draw. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, if thy word, I will let down the net. See, there in verse 5, Simon tells Jesus, he says, we've been fishing all night and we haven't been able to catch anything. How are you confident when you're not a fisherman? You don't know the right places to go or the best places to take your boat to catch fish. But you're telling us just to go out here a little bit and we're going to catch fish. And in verse 6, it tells us when they had done this, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes and their net break. And then a little later after that, he calls them to follow him like we read over in Matthew. And as I was reading that and thinking on it and pondering on it, I just couldn't get out of my head. There was this whole sea of fishermen, and Jesus chose to call the ones that were terrible fishermen. He chose to call the ones who couldn't catch a fish to go be fishers of men. Now just think of that. If you're looking out over this sea, are you going to call the ones who are able to catch the fish? In our human minds, we're going to want to call those that are able to catch fish. But as I was thinking on that and studying on it, I just wanted to come encourage y'all this morning that no matter how good or bad you think you are at something, God has a plan for your life, and he wants to use you just like he did these fishermen.
Amen.
A lot of us that are preachers or have been called to preach will talk about how we don't like being up in front of people talking. We don't like all the eyes being on us, all the attention being on us. And I still don't, and I'm sure Nick and Ryan could say the same thing and the other preachers in here. It's hard to get up and talk in front of people, but God will give you the strength to do that.
Amen.
If he calls you to go talk to somebody at school, one of your friends maybe who doesn't know Jesus, or he's calling you just to live a life in front of them that reflects Jesus and his love, that can be hard sometimes, but he's going to give you the ability. And if he calls you to do something, he's going to give you the power to do it.
Amen.
So I just wanted to encourage y'all with that this morning. And I know that they talk about praying for me, but more than praying for me, because I'm really not scared about this trip. I am a little nervous, but I'm confident that if God's called me to go, he's going to keep me safe. These two guys are the ones that need some prayers. They're scared. Well, her more than anybody, she's scared to death. And I know Dad probably is too. So y'all just pray for them while I'm gone, if y'all don't care. But I'm going to pray for us, and we can carry on this morning. God, I just want to thank you for this day and allow us to come to your house. I thank you for these kids, God, and their parents for bringing them to church, God, and having them where they need to be this morning, God. I just pray that you would use these kids in their school, in their sports, whatever they may do, God, that you could just use them as a light to show your love to people, God. And we just thank you for how good you've been to us. We just pray for the rest of this service, for the singing and the testimonies, and Brother Nick, as he comes to preach, God, that you would just move this morning, and if there's someone here lost, you just save them, or if there's somebody away from you, God, you would just draw them home this morning. We ask all this in your name, amen.
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 this on here because this is going to be his dude, his song. Ray had asked us to do this song, so I want him to sing it.
Or
you can help me. But I put him off for the last three Sundays because it's been the hectic Sundays, I guess you might say. And that's a good thing to have when you're got a lot going on in church. That's a good thing to have. So many people wanting to do stuff.
Amen.
And I'm just thankful that our church is growing like it is. Thankful for all these visitors that we got, and we just pray, Lord, that y'all have a good time in the and worshiping the Lord with us, because that's what we're here for.
Amen.
Worship the Lord. But I'm glad to see these youngins that wants to do stuff, you know, because we're getting old. And believe it or not, one day we won't be here. That's hard to believe, ain't it? But I'm so proud that these young men and young ladies wants to do stuff in this church, because it just warms my heart for them to ask me to help them do something like this, you know, because this is their future right here. Thought number one would surely be me. I thought I could be what I wanted to be. I thought I could build on life's sinking sand, but I can't even without you holding my hand. I thought I could do a lot on my own. Thought I could make it all alone. I thought of myself as a mighty big man, but Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountain's too high, and the valley's too wide. Down on my knees, that's where I've learned to stand. But Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, if I didn't trust him, I'd be less than
morning. Y'all know I don't sing a whole lot, so the only reason I'm up here is because the Lord has told me He wants me to sing. He has been all over my week this week. The Holy Spirit has been so present in everything I've been working on all week. How could I tell Him no? He's got something going on. He's moving in a major way. For those of you that haven't felt it or recognized it yet, get ready, because it's going to get so vivid that there's going to be no denying it. He's lit a fire under me personally, and again, that's why I'm up here. It's time to not be comfortable anymore.
Amen.
So. I sense an awesome moving of the Holy Spirit. I see His countenance resting on your face. I know that there are angels hovering all around us, for the presence of the Lord is in this place. He is here. Hallelujah, He is here. Amen, He is here. Holy, holy, I will bless His name again. He is here. Listen closely. Hear Him calling out your name. He is here. You can touch Him. You will never be the same. I've searched for peace among the shadows, dark and lonely. I gave up on finding that strong and lasting love. I've tasted all the things that sin could think to offer me. But today I feast on manna from above. He is here. Hallelujah. He is here. Amen. He is here. Holy, holy, I will bless His name again. He is here. Listen closely. Hear Him calling out your name. He is here. You can touch Him. You will never be the same.
Amen. Appreciate the good singing this morning. If you got your Bibles, we're going to be in the book of Luke once again, chapter 23. Luke chapter 23. And while you're turning there, I wonder if anybody's got a word or a testimony this morning. Nobody. Luke 23, we're starting verse number 35. As mentioned last week, we started the seven sayings of Jesus from the cross. And we're going to be on the second one this week, and it's one that's it's familiar. A lot we can look at in this scripture. So if you would, please stand once you get there for the reading of God's word. We're going to dig into it. Luke 23, verse 35, when you stood up, say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The Bible says in verse 35, and the people stood beholding, and the rulers also with them derided him, saying, he saved others, let him save himself, if he be Christ, the chosen of God. And the soldiers also mocked him, and coming to him and offering him vinegar, and saying, if thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. And the superscription was also written over him in letters of Greek and Latin and Hebrew, this is the king of the Jews. And one of the malefactors, one of the other prisoners, which were hanged, railed on him, saying, if thou be Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, dost thou not fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due rewards of our deeds, but this man hath done nothing amiss or nothing wrong. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, verily, I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, we come to you again this morning, just thanking you again for this day, this opportunity to be in your house, Father. We thank you for the singing we've heard. God, I pray now as we come to preaching time, oh God, that you would just help us this morning. God, I pray that we would be able to see the heart of Christ in this passage of Scripture. Father God, I pray if there's one in here this morning, God, that is lost and undone and God, in need of a Savior, oh God, I pray that they would see the grace of God. God, I pray if there's one away from you this morning, God, you'd draw them home. And God, I pray this morning that you would just do a mighty work in this place. God, I pray you would decrease me in this moment. Increase your Holy Spirit. And we're going to give you all the glory for it. Father, we thank you for all things, but most of all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus. It's in his name that I pray. And all God's children say,
amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Last week, if you remember, we talked about the first saying of Christ on Calvary. And we find that in verse 34, where Jesus looks down at those that were accusing him and mocking him and gambling for his clothing. And he looks down and he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And when we talked about that in great detail last week. We talked about the grace of God in that. If you wasn't here for whatever reason, we've come to the point that Christ is on the cross. He's been falsely accused. He's been led to Golgotha or Calvary, as some say, and he's been nailed to the cross, and he has been stood up, and he is there now. And the first words that we find Jesus say is that which we said last week, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. We talked about the fact that you can tell a lot about a person when their back's against the wall, like Christ is now. You can tell their real intention. You can tell their real heart. You can tell their real motive. And we find that Jesus is still full of grace. He's still full of mercy. He's still full of love. And so we talked about that. And we come to the second saying of Jesus here. And we find it in the same passage of Scripture. And we see that the people, after he even says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. They must not really understand who I am. They must not really understand my intention and why I've come. And we see that they are still ridiculing him and everything that he does and everything that he says. And I think that's the first thing we see there in verses 35 through 39 is the ridiculing that's going on to Christ. Let's read it once again. It says, and the people stood beholding, and the rulers also with them derided him, saying, he saved others, and let him save himself, if he be Christ, the chosen one. They've heard the proclamation of Jesus saying, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. They've heard those things, and they've seen the miracles, and they've heard evidence of the miracles that has happened. And they said, I tell you what, if he is Christ, if he is really who he says he is, if he's able to do all these great and wonderful and mighty things, then let him just save himself. Let him just save himself. goes on, and it says, and the soldiers also mocked him, coming to him and offering him vinegar, and saying, if thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself. And the superscription was also written above him, that this is the king of the Jews. But not only was it just the rulers, not only was it just the those that were around him and the bystanders, but even the prisoner that was on the cross beside him railed on him, saying, if thou be Christ, save thyself and us. Save thyself and us. We understand, and we read through Scripture and read through the Gospels, the account that Christ has taught, the fact that when somebody smacks you on one cheek, turn the other cheek to them, right? And we understand that he's been able to take one lick after another lick, not physically, but emotionally. The physical part is kind of, at this point, it's kind of subsided for a little while. Now it's just all emotional, Charlie. It's all just, they're just tackling him emotionally and mentally. And how many people know that you can get as mentally beat down as you can physically beat down? And we must understand, as we talked about last week, although Christ is 100% God, he is still 100% man. He feels those things on the inside, those emotions that he has. But I couldn't help but think about how he has said, you know what, when somebody persecutes you, I tell you what, pray for them, lift them up. And we see that he's already done that. But I think about all the people that are standing around there at Calvary watching what's going on. I think about his family. I think about Mary, his mother, sitting at the foot of the cross, seeing her son being nailed to a tree, being stood up, folks gambling for his clothes, seeing them being ridiculed. So she knows exactly who he is.
Amen.
She had an angel come to her and say, I tell you what, you're going to give birth to the Son of God. She knows exactly who it is, but nobody else is buying into it. And she has to sit there and see her son be ridiculed. And I don't guess that really carries a lot of weight until you have a child.
Amen.
You can pick on me all you want to. You mess with one of them three young'uns back there, we're going to have problems. I'm just telling you. That's just, as parents, that's how we're wired up, is it not?
Amen.
And to see Mary have to endure and see all this, man, carries a lot of weight. The audacity of these people to ridicule him and to look at him, some of his disciples, some of them done left him high and dry, but with some of them sitting there, they've seen the things that he's done with their own eyes. They've seen him walk on water. They've seen him deliver people. And yet, the ridiculing that he's taking. The audacity of these people to think, well, I mean, we talked about it last week, and it's going to be a common thing, but like, legit, what has Christ done at this point to cause anybody any problems? He's made people better. He's fed those that were hungry. He's done all, and yet this is the payment that he gets. We see the ridiculing that happens. But not only, like I said, the guards and the bystanders, but also the criminals that are beside him. You think if anybody would have maybe an ounce of compassion out of anybody, it would be the two guys that was beside him. And we see in this passage that we're preaching out of today that just one of them ridiculed him. But I want you to take your Bibles. I've got a lot of scripture references this morning, and I'm going to quote most of them. But I do want you to turn to these. I think this is very important. In Matthew 27... and also in Mark 15. Matthew 27. That's one of a preacher's favorite sounds, to hear the people of God turning their Bibles.
Amen.
Matthew 27, verse 38. The Bible tells us that there were two thieves crucified with him, one on the right and the other on the left. If you skip down to verse number 44, it says, the thieves, y'all see the S on the end of that? The thieves also, which were crucified with him, cast the same in his teeth, which means they both ridiculed him. We flip to Mark chapter number 15 and verse number 32. Mark 15, verse 32 says, let Christ, the King of Israel, descend now from the cross, that we may see and believe. And they that were crucified with him reviled him. So we got two passages, one in Matthew, one in Mark,
that said not just one of the thieves, but both of the thieves looked at Christ and started ridiculing him about who he was. They understand that they were completely human and they probably done some dumb stuff and they probably deserved to be hung on the cross. But they look at him and say, I tell you what, if you are who you say you are, won't you just take your little self down and take us with you if you're able to do that. You think about this ridiculing, like at some point, do we not realize I'm a patient guy to a point. But the pop blows off. Anybody else like it? Like you can take a good bit, but Daniel, you ain't like it? No. But there comes a point, the pop blows off. Christ never gets there. There has been times in the Old Testament that God got there. You say, tell me one. What about the flood? There come a point that God said, I tell you what, enough's enough. Enough's enough, and he sent a flood. There's been times, think about, how about even Jonah. Enough's enough, Jonah. You've run far enough. I'm going to show you who I really am. But there's like no fear of these people. No fear that like Christ in all of his glory could have took himself off of that cross and he could have struck everybody right there dead and been perfectly justified in who he was, but he didn't do it. We see the grace of God in that. And we see the ridiculing that he was able to take one lick after another lick after another lick. And I think it shows us a principle and a morale that we should carry around as Christians. Is the fact that there's going to be times if you live a life that does, the Bible says, and we'll look at it here in a minute, but if you're going to live a life, you desire to live a godly life, that you're going to face a little persecution along the way. You're gonna face a little persecution, whether it may even be at home, it may be at work, it may be at school, it might even be in your own church house that you're gonna face a little bit of persecution. But I tell you what, Christ endured and we ought to endure as well.
Amen.
You know what I find great comfort? The fact the Bible says in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 4 and verse number 15 and 16, the Bible says, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but one that was tempted in all things as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, let us draw near with confidence to the throne of grace so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. Everything that we will ever go through as a Christian, whether it's a struggle or a temptation or even being ridiculed for your faith, Christ went through the same thing. And knowing that he went through the same thing, he is able to come to our rescue. He is able to come to our help. The Bible tells us that we can draw near the throne of grace. But not just near, but with confidence, knowing that we serve a God that is full of grace and is full of mercy and is able to come to our help and our rescue if we'll just come to him. So you may be here this morning. You may be facing that at work. You may be facing some guys at work that they don't like how you talk with a clean mouth. They don't like how you talk about Jesus. They don't like how you don't when somebody tells a dirty joke, you walk out. They may not like that. Just keep on, right? Don't give in now. It may be if they don't like it, they've noticed something. How about that?
Amen.
Let them just keep noticing it. And maybe God will just keep working on that heart for them. And you just never know. The Lord may save them. You may be at school, young folks. Let me tell you something. School's tough. It's hard. Everybody in school wants you to drink. They want you to do drugs. They want you to have sex. They want you to do all these things, cheat on tests and all that. Just keep staying strong, all right? You're going to get ridiculed if you don't participate in those things, but just stay strong. Just stay strong. Daddies, mama may not want to go to church. Kids may not want to go to church. Mamas, daddy may not want to go to church. Kids may not want. Just keep going to church.
Amen.
Just take that ridiculing. Just take the persecution. Just take whatever. Because I'm going to tell you something. Christ endured it and he come out victorious. And I believe that if we'll just stand firm and trust God that we can come out victorious as well.
Amen.
But we must endure the ridiculing. The Bible says in a book, Paul writes to Timothy. In 2 Timothy, I believe it is, chapter 3, verse number 12. He tells him. He said, Timothy's a young pastor of a church that some days they loved Jesus and some days they didn't. Some days they wanted to hear the word of God and some days they didn't. Some days they wanted the truth. Some days they wanted it just like it was. And some days they just wanted it sugar-coated. And here's what Paul tells Timothy. He says, Timothy, all who desire to live godly will be persecuted. So So I just want to give you fair warning from Guest Baptist Church this morning. If you've got a desire to live godly, if you've got a desire to live after the things of God and seek His face, that you're going to face a little persecution along the way.
Amen.
And if you're not facing a little persecution along the way, you might ought to check up.
Amen.
You might ought to check up. We see the first thing is the ridiculing. Second thing we see, I think, in this passage is the repentance. Is the repentance. Verse number 40. But the other answering, what we just seen in verse 39, that one of the malefactors, one of the other prisoners, railed on him. But in verse 40, we see that the other rebuked the other malefactor. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, "Dost thou not fear God, seeing that thou art in the same condemnation?" You see, you study this, and you read different commentators, and some commentators just don't know why Mark and Matthew say that both of them was railing on Jesus, and Luke says just one of them was railing on Jesus. They just can't figure it out, and I don't know 100% either, but here's kind of what I think. Here's kind of what I think, Brother Charlie, that they're there, and they're on the cross, and both these guys has lost his last year's Easter egg, all right? I mean, they're lost. And they're both railing on him, railing on him. And I see the one thief on the other side, man, he's just giving it to him. I tell you what, if you're the Son of God, you'll just take yourself off, take us with you. And I see this other guy, he's kind of there. But there's something. He just kind of looks and he sees Jesus just keep taking it. And just keep taking it. And just keep taking it. And I think something comes up over on the inside of him and he says, you know what? Maybe he is a son of God.
Amen.
Maybe, because if he's the Son of God, he could take himself off that cross. But if he's the Son of God, then maybe he really could just sit right there and take it. Maybe he really is who he says he is. Maybe he did come to die on an old rugged cross for everybody's sin.
Amen.
And we see that he sits there. And it's like something comes over him, and he says, you know what? He finally looks at the other guy and said, would you shut up? You're under the same condemnation that he is. What are you doing? And he goes on and he says, and we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man hath done nothing wrong. But this man has done nothing wrong. And he said, Jesus, what's that next word he says, Charlie?
Lord,
remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. You say, Brother Nick, what are you talking about? We just seen salvation take place at the cross of Calvary.
Amen.
We see this man right here. He went from not knowing that he was a sinner, not knowing that he was lost and on his way to hell, to coming to the point saying, you know what? There is the perfect Son of God. I can see the Holy Spirit revealed to him. I can now see my sin. I can see that I'm wrong. I can see that he's not wrong. He is perfect and he is complete and he is everything that God needed him to be, but I am not. I'm weak and I'm frail. And he comes to the point that he says, I know that I'm a sinner. I know that I'm getting my just deed that I deserve. And he looks at Christ and he says, Lord. And when somebody says, Lord, guess what? They just confess that Jesus is Lord of their life.
Amen.
And he said, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. That's how salvation works, y'all. You see, the Holy Spirit reveals to you that you are a sinner. Here's what I think. Here's what I know, actually. That you can't come to Christ unless the Lord lets you know you're lost.
Amen.
How do you know that you need to be found when you don't even know that you're lost? But when the Lord pricks your heart and lets you know that you're a sinner, lets you know that you are not right with God, and there's no way to get right with God other than to go through the blood of Calvary, that's when you can get saved.
Amen.
And we see right here, He said, I'm indeed justly getting what we receive due reward of our deeds. But this man hath done nothing wrong. And he said, Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. See that he was convicted. He turned from his sin. And he trusted Christ as Savior. Sometimes we make salvation so hard, y'all. Sometimes we make it so difficult. Let me tell you something. This man was never baptized. This man never joined a church.
Amen.
This man didn't know all the books of the Bible. This man didn't have a perfect Sunday school attendance, but I'm going to tell you something. He's in heaven today.
Amen.
He's in heaven today. Don't you think for one second, if you're in here this morning, that God can't save you.
Amen.
Let me tell you something. He'll save the vilest of them.
Amen.
He's able. Let me tell you, the Bible tells...
Bless you, Lord.
The Bible tells us that we don't serve a short-armed God.
Amen.
But he's able to reach way down. Amen. Way down in the muck and the mire and to drag you out of whatever you're in. Don't matter where you're at, where you've been, how bad you are, you ain't no better than his grace, I can tell you that.
Amen.
You ain't no better than his grace is good. We see how he came. We see that he was broken of his sin. He knew that he was lost. The Bible says in Psalm 51, in verse number 17, it says, "For thou desirest not sacrifice, else I would give it. Thou delightest not in a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a contrite heart. Oh God, thou wilt not despise." You want to come to God, you can't come puffed up. You can't come proud. If you want to come to God, it's got to be with a broken spirit and a contrite heart. Broken spirit and a contrite heart. First, we've seen the ridiculing. Secondly, we see the repentance. And lastly, oh, but certainly not least, we see redemption.
Amen.
We see redemption. Verse 43. "And Jesus said unto him, Verily, I say unto thee, today shall thou be with me in paradise."
Amen.
"Verily, I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise." Salvation is a gift, guys. Salvation is a gift. We clearly see that this guy, he didn't do anything to earn it. The last actions he did before he was on the cross, he was a thief somewhere stealing. We see he might have committed a murder. We don't really know. We just know that he was the Bible says in one spot that they were thieves. We see that salvation is completely a gift. And sometimes I think, we don't understand, I don't understand how somebody who's followed Christ for 50, 60, 70 years, and somebody who's followed Christ for 5 minutes gets the same heaven. They get the same heaven. Let me tell you why. Because it took the blood of Jesus in both situations.
Amen.
It took the blood of Jesus in both situations. Sometimes it don't even seem fair. Sometimes it don't seem right. But if you sit and you survey where God brought you from, I'm going to tell you something. You were just as vile as that thief.
Amen.
You were just as vile as him. And praise God. Praise God. He didn't have to earn his way in. But it was by the grace of God that he got in. It was by the grace of God that he got in. There's a scripture that kind of teaches on that. Matthew chapter 20. You don't have to turn there. I'll just tell you about it. You can write it in your notes and read it later. But it's the parable of the unfair wages. And it said this guy, he went out and he had a farm. Went out about the 6th hour, I believe it was, 6 a.m., whatever they called that, and got him some workers for the day. And they agreed on a price. They agreed a denarii. What they call that was a day's wage. They agreed on a day's wage, and they went to work, and he showed them what to do. Said a little while later, he went back, about 3 hours later, he went back to the marketplace, and there was some other folks standing idle there, and he said, "Won't you come work with me at my farm?" So he took them. About 4 times this guy went, and he did this, and the last time he went, they only had 1 hour of work left, Brother Josh. And he went, and he said, "Won't you come work with me?" When payday come, It says those that were hired last got paid first. And when they got paid, the farmer gave them what the guys that come early that morning gave them that day's wage. And the Bible says that they were back there thinking, we're going to get a lot more than he told us we was going to get. But when it got their turn to get up there, guess what they got? They got the day's wage that they were given. He said, Brother Nick, what's that got to do with anything? It's the same, heaven's the same way.
Amen.
Heaven's the same way. Let me tell you something. You may be, we got some gray hair in this here this morning. That's a good thing to have gray hair in your church. Amen.
Amen.
You may be 60, 70, 80 this morning, never trusted Christ. I'm going to tell you something. You can have the same heaven as all these other folks that's
Amen.
Been here.
Amen.
Brother David, how old was you?
60.
That's some folks your age you saved back when they was 10. I'm going to tell you, you're going to the same heaven they're going to.
Amen.
You know why? Because it's the grace of God.
Amen.
It's nothing
Amen.
That any of us could
Amen.
Ever do to attain salvation, but it's by the blood of Jesus at
Amen.
The cross of Calvary. And we see this man right here gets to experience the same paradise that you and I, if you know Christ, will get to experience one day. This man's going from the cross to paradise. I love what the Bible teaches in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 through 8. Paul's writing to them. It says, therefore we are always confident, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, that we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing, rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Let me tell you something. When this guy passed away on the cross, I believe he came into the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
See, it's that quick, y'all. If you've been saved, blood-bought, and born again, we've got eternal life, what we've been promised. And guess what that means? While we may physically die, we ain't spiritually. Hey, let me tell you, when you got saved, eternal life started at that point right there.
Amen.
And it goes through
Amen.
Eternity. I want to ask you this morning. If you died today, where would you wake up in eternity? Where would you wake up in eternity? There's two options. There's a place called heaven and there's a place called hell.
Amen.
And you ain't getting into heaven without Jesus.
Amen.
If you don't call on his name, just as this guy on the cross did. He was convicted of his sin. He knew he was lost and undone. And he knew there's only one way to get to God, and that was through his son Jesus. And he confessed Jesus as Lord of his life. And we see redemption happened in verse 43. Verily I say unto thee, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Today thou shalt be with me in paradise. You may be here this morning. You may be going through the ridiculing as we talked about earlier. You may be facing some persecution. Just stand firm. Just stand firm for the gospel. You may be here and you may be lost. I'm going to tell you something. Come to Christ, you've got to be with a broken and a contrite spirit. You must repent of your sin and trust him as Savior and Lord of your life. And you may be here and you may have been saved a while, and man, things seem tough and bleak sometimes, and maybe loved ones has passed away. I'm going to tell you something. Our redemption's drawing nigh, y'all.
Amen.
One of these days, we're going to get to experience that paradise, Charlie. Just stand firm. I'm going to ask everybody if they would to stand this morning.